Understanding technique in radiology. We need to realize that less than 1% of x-rays that come out of our tube when we set our technique make it to the IR. The rest will die out or get absorbed. Less than 1% of that technique is making our image. Mass, no longer in the digital world, controls density or brightness. Brightness is controlled by processing algorithms, lookup tables, rescaling. This is difficult for old school techs to realize sometimes. Look at the images created here with 4 mass, 32 mass, 200 mass, and 500 mass. Due to the processing, there's not very much noticeable difference between 4 mass and 500 mass. This would be a major difference using film screen. Just from going from film to CR, you can increase your KV by 15 or 20. However, for Conoco, it'll be 5 or 10. And for most DR, you can actually use about 10 to 15 times too much mass and still get an acceptable image. Centering and collimation will make a big difference on your index numbers. If you look here, perfect centering on the left, the LGM is 1.81. On the far right, this is the image of the same phantom elbow, however, no collimation, and see how the LGM number was increased. The center, if you take this image on this IR plate and you are off-centered, LGM is 0.737. So centering and collimation do play a big factor in what your index DI numbers will read. This makes a big difference with your technique because no longer can you look at an image like the old school days of film and know it's an acceptable image, other than a few things. One is by looking at the EI index numbers, whatever is set for the type of equipment that you use. You should definitely use the magnification to zoom in, check for any noise or burn, and you should always be able to level and window and make your image look really well penetrated and contrasty. If you have questions about window and level, please click this link here. Looking at the index and DI numbers is the key to critiquing a image. However, if you're going to look visually at the image, the only way you can tell if it's not acceptable is if it has too much quantum model, too noisy, or if there's burn. In the past, we'd be able to look at an image and tell it does not have enough KV to accept that image. Looking at these six images here, this is using the 15% rule, increasing our KV by 10 each time and doing the mass by half accordingly. Looking at the image of 50 KV to 100 KV, there is a slight difference, but not a very big noticeable difference from using 100 KV to 50 KV. This is why it's important to always look at your index numbers. Finding a caliper to measure the patient thickness to determine your mass is probably pretty rare in today's world. So setting technique, we need to be able to judge different body parts on the same thickness and set technique accordingly. For most situations, an ankle and wrist is fairly close in size. Foot and hand is fairly close. So what other parts are the same size? Most people judge things based off a shoulder or a knee, which are generally around the same thickness. Also, if you are imaging a baby, you can determine based on the size what body part it is similar to, which typically is around a knee or a shoulder as well. However, when you set a technique for a baby, always try to make that long scale if possible by using the 15% rule, by raising the KVP and lowering the mass. Now, starting out with a technique, most books will have a general idea for a KV range. However, the mass will be different due to many different factors with the type of equipment, the generators, the speed. A lot of different things go into play, and that's why textbooks cannot give a KV and a mass estimate. So as you look at the picture here on the left, you can see the KV will, depending on the size of the part, will increase as you go up more proximally towards your torso. Around 50 to 55 KV for hands and fingers, 60 KV for forearm, 65 KV for humerus, and 70 KVP for the shoulder. You can see as the part increases, so does the KVP. As the part increases, so will your mass. This is a picture on the right that's typically passed around a lot of online Facebook groups. However, this is set really with film or a different type of CR equipment. A lot of these techniques are not accurate in today's world, but I wanted to show you due to the fact you can see how the mass would increase along with the KVP. If you look at the bottom right where it shows your TIV-FIB, it says around 60 to 65 KVP with 4 to 6 mass. If you go up to the femur, you would not use less mass than you did on your tibia. You would use more. This is showing 65 to 75 KVP, which is really a short, small increase in KVP. And the mass has also went up to 12 mass for the proximal and 5 to 7 for the distal. So it's similar, but as the body part increases in size, your KVP will increase in size, and so will your mass. So as you get more proximal, the technique will go up. This also helps you on the registry with the anode heel effect and which part is placed closest to the cathode. It's always going to be the most proximal ends. The proximal ends of long bones are generally the thickest. If you're doing a femur, the hip would be placed closest to the cathode. If you're doing a humerus, it would be the shoulder. If you were doing a TIV-FIB, it would be the knee. It's always the proximal ends that are placed closest to the cathode using the anode heel effect. Remember that for your registry. Now the new digital optimum KVs, which is to get the best picture, of course, these are going to be a little intimidating and scary for techs that have been in the field for a long time and using such high KV. This is generally needed to get lower the mass and lower the patient dose. Again, for the registry, this is always the best answer is the one that has the highest KV and the lowest mass. Looking at this chart, the C-spine would generally be between 85 and 100 KV. Now, rarely would I see anybody in clinical use that, but this is the optimum KVs that are allowed that will compensate with the mass in the system to still get an optimal diagnostic image that can be read by the radiologist. Now on the right are some of the techniques that I am used to using. An abdomen around 80 at 32 is a good starting point. Sometimes even 80 or 85 at 40. Patients seem to be getting a lot bigger these days than they were in the past. For wrist and ankle and elbow, around 65 KVP, and the mass goes up accordingly. 1.5 to 2.5 for the wrist and ankle. An ankle is a little bit thicker than a wrist, generally has a little bit more adipose or even more muscle. The elbow 65 at 3, and the knee and the shoulder is generally around the same. The thickness of a shoulder is a little bit more than a knee, so a little bit bump in KV for around 5 or so, and around between 6 to 8 KV for the knee and around 8 to 10 for a shoulder, depending on male or female and how much muscle the patient has. The knees and shoulders are what people determine whether they use a grid or not. You may find some techs that use a grid for knees and some don't. Some use a grid for shoulders and some don't. Now, a few tips to consider when setting your technique. People are not typically the same size as they are thin as they are thick. Most people are not built like a basketball. Most people are twice as thick as they are thin. Meaning when you use your KVP, you typically would use double, at least double the mass if you are doing an L-spine, for example, 80 at 20 for an AP. When you turn the patient to a lateral, they are at least twice as thick as they are thin. So you need to use at least double the mass you use for the AP. For an oblique, the patient is not twice as thick, but they are thicker, about 1.5 times thicker, because you're going through, have more distance between, you have more OID, the patient's rotated up 45 degrees. So it's generally gonna be between what you use for the AP and the lateral. So around 30 or so mass, just for example. Now in using grids versus non-grids, there is a grid formula when calculating going from a grid to a non-grid. But in the tech world, the easiest thing that most people do will just double or half your mass. So let's say, for instance, you are using 70 at 40, or let's say 80 at 40 for a KUB on a patient with a grid. You probably wouldn't do it without a grid, but if you did choose to use it without a grid, maybe with a smart grid, you would need to at least half your mass because you're not going through the grid. So it would be about 80 at 20. The same thing for your RNF room or your rad room. If you're using that in a Bucky is acting as a grid. The grid ratio may not be exactly the same, but if you were to do, let's say, a knee in the Bucky at 75 at 10, and you would go in to do a portable and recovery afterwards on that patient, you would use 75 at 5. You would just half it because you're taking the grid away. Remember, anytime there's something between the IR and the tube, you need to increase your technique, whether that's a tumor, a mass, filtration, thickness of body parts, any of those things that are added between the tube and the IR, you need to increase your technique. So if you're adding a grid between the IR and the tube, you need to definitely increase your technique. If you have any questions on that, please click this video here. Most portable units are set at 100 mA. Now, why is this important? If you are doing a large abdomen on a 400-pound patient and you need to use, well, let's just say even 40 mass, for example, and you in the room can set 400 mA and 0.001 to get your 40 mass. However, on a portable, when you set your 40 mass, it's going to be times 100 mA station, making your exposure time 4 seconds. That's why when you hear that long exposure, it's being set at that 100 mA fixed station and getting the seconds accordingly. It's a little difficult to get a good image on a large patient with a portable. The best thing to do with a KUB is definitely bring them to the room or have a transporter bring them to the room where you can use a higher mA station to get a lower time. So here's the key question you get asked all the time. Do you increase the KBP, increase the mass, or both? Now look at the study that you're doing. The only long scale type studies that we have are chest x-rays and abdomens. Everything else is going to be short scale. So if you need to go up in either of those, it's wise to go up in KVP if you're doing a long scale type study and your index number is a little bit low, because you can increase your KVP and still remain long scale. However, you may see most techs probably bump up the mass a step or two. And this could be because increasing the mass by just a little bit will increase your index number accordingly. Increasing your KVP sometimes by 15% would be double that. So most techs, when they see their index number and they need to have it raised, if they increase that KVP, that could actually double that index number or bring it up 2 or 3 steps. So increasing the mass as a tech is probably a little easier. But again, if it's a short scale study, you know, the mass is probably the key to increase. If it's a long scale study, if it's chest x-ray or KUB, increase on the KVP. But again, remember, if it's on the registry, the answer is always to increase the KVP, and because it's going to be a lower patient dose. So we're discussing earlier, you could use a higher KVP and lower mass on everything. You could choose to do everything at 110 KVP and do the 15% rule accordingly. But you definitely wouldn't want to do that, because in the digital world, you still need to stay within the optimum range of KVP that your book is suggesting. You can't start using 110 or 120 KVP on everything. If you do use too much KVP, it's going to penetrate right through your patient. It's going to hit the plate or detector because of that incorrect attenuation. This is going to cause the image to be overpenetrated. It's going to be saturated. It's going to cause a permanent loss in the contrast. If you have any questions about KVP and how it works, please click this video here. If you are a student understanding technique, it can be a little challenging and disheartening when you don't have text there that actually will walk you through on how it works and why. Remember, the book will have fixed KVs that they recommend for different size body parts, but the mass is up to the type of equipment. So when you get to your clinical site, the best thing to do is to go into the portable and look at all the body parts, write them down in a book or on a card on what technique it recommends. Choose grid and non-grid and look at those techniques. Choose the body part, choose the patient size. Also go to the rad room and go and set up for a knee or a shoulder. Turn off the AEC and look at the fixed technique on what it's recommending. Compare that with the portable and see if it's a big difference. If there is, there's probably a little bit of a difference with the grid ratios. But it's important when you get to clinical, always look at the techniques that are in the system that are built and use those. The second thing, get yourself a little address book and put the techniques in there. Each body part can go under a certain letter in the alphabet on that phone, little phone book you have. You can get a little technique card you can see on Etsy and Amazon. I'd be warned, a few of those are severely off. I've seen one where there's a very popular seller and the person is located in Canada and their equipment is obviously a little different because those techniques are something that we would never use here in the States. Super high KVs and super high mass. So make sure you verify that technique card if you're going to buy it off Etsy with the clinical team. The third thing, if you are not doing the image yourself and you are watching another student or another tech, try to guess what the technique's going to read out as that person is being positioned. Make sure you look and see, are they centered? Are they collimated? That'll make a big difference, but you need to be able to check that index numbers. That is the key. If the index number came out and it was low and your technique you guessed was higher, then you were probably more accurate. And the reverse is true as well. If that index number came out too high and you thought the technique would be a little bit lower that it would read out, then you would be right. Definitely do not waste your time. I hear over and over again students saying you were never taught technique in school. Well, that may be true. It may be your instructors are not focusing on it much because the computer does it for you. Same thing for the techs. They may not enjoy teaching or understand it themselves. But this is your money. You're paying for the education. Make sure this is something you understand. Thank you for watching. Please like, comment, and subscribe. If you have any ideas for future videos, please let us know. Remember, always advance, never repeat.